Hello, I'm Robyn McDonald, and welcome to Storytime. 100 years ago, Congress passed the 19th Amendment guaranteeing women the right to vote in any and all elections throughout all then the 48 states, and any future states, of course. Rockford had a number of very articulate voices at the time, and a little later we will be talking about them. But before we get into anything else in our story, I want to go over a few vocabulary words. One is the word amendment. An amendment is a change or an addition to a document. Suffrage is simply the right to vote. To ratify means to give approval or consent for. And ballot. A ballot is simply the act of voting in secrecy. Now, the U.S. Constitution does not specifically prohibit suffrage by women, but neither does it specifically permit it. So Wyoming and about 15 other states had already, by this time, had given permission for women to vote. In fact, they welcomed it. But there was a large number of states that did not do that. And so it was very important for the need of an amendment to be added to the Constitution to guarantee that right. And this is what the amendment says. The right of citizens of the United States to vote shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or by any state on account of sex. And with that, we will begin our story. The book I'll be reading is Susan B. Anthony, Fighter for Women's Rights. It was written by Deborah Hopkinson and illustrated by Amy Bates. Chapter 1. Susan B. Anthony was born in 1820. When Susan lived, not all people in America had the right to live and work as they pleased. Some people were slaves with no rights at all. Women didn't have many rights either. Married women couldn't own land, and girls couldn't go to college. Susan wanted to reform or change America. She believed American women should have the right to vote, just as men did. And with her friend Elizabeth Cady Stanton, Susan spent her life fighting for women's rights. But the fight to win the vote took longer than Susan ever imagined. Susan Bromwell Anthony was born in Massachusetts. Her father, Daniel, was a Quaker. He believed in a simple life of hard work. Susan's father owned a mill where young women wove cloth. 11 of the mill girls lived with Susan's big family. Susan and her sisters helped their mother cook and clean for all these people. It took all day to bake 20 loaves of bread. Unlike many people at the time, Susan's father believed girls should get an education. Susan learned to read when she was only 4. But long hours of reading books in poor light hurt her eyes, and Susan's right eye became crossed because of reading in poor light, and it stayed that way her whole life. Even so, Susan loved learning. Sometimes she went to school, and other times she was taught at home. When Susan was 11, she asked her father to make a young woman the boss of the other workers in the mill because Susan could see that the woman knew more than the boss, who was a man. Susan's father said no. Although he thought women and men were equal, he wasn't ready to change how things were done. And in those days, a man was always the boss. Susan loved her father, but she couldn't understand his decision. Why shouldn't a woman be the boss? Why not start changing the world? Susan began asking hard questions like these when she was a young girl, and she never stopped. When Susan was in her teens, hard times hit. Her father lost his mill and even their house. To help out, Susan became a teacher at a boarding school. She missed her family very much. Soon, though, Susan got used to being on her own. She did well and became a head teacher. Although Susan had boyfriends, in the end, she decided not to marry. She didn't want to give up her independence. After 10 years of teaching, Susan was ready to take on new challenges. Somehow, Susan wanted to help make America a better place. But what could one woman do? Chapter 2. Susan was almost 30 when she went home to live on her family's new farm near Rochester, New York. Now, at first, Susan spent time helping out on the family farm, but soon she was spending most of her time with other people like herself who wanted to reform America. It was just like Susan to rush off to an important meeting and forget to water the raspberries. Many of Susan's new friends were abolitionists, people who wanted to abolish or end slavery. Susan and her family became part of the Underground Railroad, a group of people who helped runaway slaves escape north to Canada and to freedom. Susan's home became a gathering place for abolitionists. And then in 1851, Susan visited the town of Seneca Falls, New York. And there on the street corner, she was introduced to Elizabeth Cady Stanton. Susan was excited to meet Mrs. Stanton. Mrs. Stanton was already famous for her work for women's rights. Susan knew that Mrs. Stanton, along with Lucretia Mott, had organized the first Women's Rights Convention in July of 1848. Now, at this meeting, Mrs. Stanton had declared that women were equal with men. She said married women should be able to own property. Most important of all, Mrs. Stanton believed women should have the right to vote. Just about everyone thought Elizabeth Cady Stanton was foolish to demand the vote for American women. But Susan agreed with Mrs. Stanton. She realized that unless women could vote, own property, and be full citizens, they'd never have the power over their own lives or equal rights with men. Chapter 3. Before long, Susan and Mrs. Stanton became close friends and leaders of the right for women's rights. Since Mrs. Stanton often had to stay home with her small children, it was up to Susan to spread the word. Susan set out to bring the message about women's rights to people all over the New York State. Susan B. Anthony had found her work. Susan spent long hours on the road. She traveled alone by train or carriage. Sometimes she braved snowstorms in an open sleigh. To help pay her way, Susan charged 25 cents for her speeches. Sometimes hundreds of people came to hear her speak, but other times only a few showed up. Susan spoke simply and directly about the need to change laws that hurt women. She urged women to stand up for themselves and to be independent and strong. Susan said a woman should make her own choices, do her own work, and stand on her own feet. And that's exactly what Susan B. Anthony herself was doing. Chapter 4. Along with speaking out for women, Susan also worked with abolitionists to end slavery. The abolitionist men had one goal, to free enslaved people. They were glad to have Susan fight for their cause, but they didn't want to fight for women's rights. In 1861, the Civil War began. And during the war, all anyone could think about was the struggle between the North and the South. But in 1865, the Civil War ended. Once the slaves were free, Susan hoped that all Americans, white and black, men and women, would gain the right to vote. In 1865, Congress passed the 14th Amendment to the U.S. Constitution. This gave voting rights to former slaves, but only the men. All women, black and white, would have to wait. Many women, including Susan, Mrs. Stanton, and Sojourner Truth, a former slave herself, were angry and upset about this, yet they had no choice. They had to keep fighting. Susan and Mrs. Stanton traveled from state to state speaking out for women's suffrage, the right to vote. They also formed the National Women's Suffrage Association, working to change laws in the way people thought was hard. Even the women who cared most about equal rights couldn't always agree on the best way to get America to change. But Susan never gave up. Chapter 5. In 1872, Susan put America's laws to the test. On election day, she and more than 100 women across the nation went to the polls to cast their votes. "Well, I have been and gone and done it," she wrote to her dear friend, Mrs. Stanton. And just as she expected, Susan was arrested. She didn't go to jail, but she was put on trial. The judge found her guilty. When he asked Susan if she had anything to say, she leapt to her feet and gave a daring speech, but it was no use. On July 4th, 1876, America turned 100. In a celebration in Philadelphia, the Declaration of Independence was read. At the end, to everyone's surprise, Susan got up and handed out a new declaration, a Declaration of Rights for Women. Susan and other women took their fight to the Congress. Beginning in 1887, Congress looked at changing the U.S. Constitution to give women the vote. But year after year, Congress said no. In February of 1906, Susan B. Anthony turned 86. Her dear friend, Mrs. Stanton, had died a few years earlier. Susan attended her last women's rights meeting, helping to raise money for the future. When it was time for Susan's last speech, she struggled to her feet as the audience applauded. Susan's voice rang out clear. She urged women not to give up. "Failure is impossible," she cried. Susan B. Anthony died just a few weeks later. It took American women another 14 years until 1920 to win the right to vote. And that is the end of our story. So let's talk a little bit about the 19th Amendment. The 19th Amendment passed the U.S. legislature in 1919, but it needed to be ratified by 36 states. In August 1920, Tennessee became that 36th state to ratify the amendment. And so Congress ratified that new amendment, and we have the 19th added. The date was August 26th, 1920. Now over behind me, we have a sash, Vote for Women. And on that sash are three important colors. There was the gold, there was the purple, and there was white. The gold signified all the people who had gone before. It was Susan B. Anthony, it was Elizabeth Cady Stanton, it was Lucretia Mott, it was Alice Paul, all the ones who had come before to help it become ratified. The purple represented their loyalty, and the white, of course, represents purity and virtue. Together, it was their colors for sisterhood of the suffragette movement. The black box you'll see behind me was a ballot box, and initially, women had to use a separate ballot box as well as separate ballots. So this ballot box that we have here came from the 9th District from the Winnebago County Courthouse, and it was used for the first year that women were allowed to vote. By 1921, they did away with separate boxes and separate ballots, and women's ballots were included in the same box with the men's ballots. The last thing I have to show you are these. It's a pair of undergarments called bloomers. Now, the bloomers became a very important symbol of the suffragette movement. Miss Anthony, she loved the bicycle. She felt like the bicycle did more to emancipate women than anything else. And there was a few reasons why that was. One was you didn't need to have somebody help you saddle that bicycle. You didn't have to hook it up to a wagon, have somebody help you harness, get that wagon hooked up to the horse. You could get on your bicycle and ride, so it offered a woman great amount of independence. The other thing it did was it changed your fashion. Women no longer had to wear 7 layers of clothing. You can't ride a bicycle in 7 layers of clothing. So your skirts got shorter, they got more minimal, you didn't have to wear as many layers, and you started wearing bloomers, the loose-fitting bloomers underneath your skirt. And this became the symbol of your suffragettes, your bloomers. Now, Rockford had 3 very prominent voices in our town. One was Jane Addams, Ruth Hannah McCormick, and Kate O'Connor. Jane Addams was from Stevenson County. She graduated from Rockford Female Seminary in 1881, but today we know it as Rockford University. She was president of her class and a valedictorian. She was a tireless supporter for women's rights, but later on concerned herself with a larger ambition of international peace. Ruth Hannah McCormick, while not being from Rockford originally, she was born in Ohio, she moved to Chicago and then later to Rockford. She was very involved in politics. Her husband was in politics. And one of her concerns was the need for fresh food and milk for people that she saw near her. So what she did was they bought a dairy farm in Byron, Illinois, and they began selling the milk to those in need that she knew close to her. She was active in politics and Illinois Equal Suffrage Act of 1913. She was certain that her husband had lost a very important election to him because not enough women were voting. So she concerned herself with getting women involved. She was the first woman elected to a statewide office, serving in the House of Representatives for 1 term. Kate O'Connor was born in Rockford and graduated from Rockford High School in 1878. 4 years later, she was appointed deputy of the county clerk for Winnebago County before she opened her own private office. She was very outspoken on the issue of women's suffrage. Since voting is one way a citizen can help to shape their government, it stands to reason that we are indebted to people like Anthony and Stanton, Mott and Paul, Adams, McCormick and O'Connor, and so many of the others. So we do right to commemorate this day. Thank you. I have one other book I could recommend to you if you have an older student who is a proficient reader. It is called Why Couldn't Susan B. Anthony Vote? And Other Questions About Women's Suffrage. It is a beautiful book, and it was written by Mary K. Carson. And inside as well, she discusses our bloomer story that we talked about.